पंजाबी, मिस पूजा पंजाबी साइकोलॉजिस्ट, हाइपनो बर्थिंग प्रैक्टिशनर एंड पर्सनल मेंटर. शी इज एमएससी साइकोलॉजी एंड इज ट्रेंड इन वेरी डिफरेंट हीलिंग मॉडलिटीज. शी इज इन प्राइवेट प्रैक्टिस फॉर मोर देन 10 ईयर्स. शी इज ऑल्सो कंसल्टेंट एट वसंत दादा कॉलेज ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग फॉर लास्ट 6 ईयर्स. शी इज कैटरिंग टू ऑल एज ग्रुप्स टू एड इन ए होलसम डेवलपमेंट ऑफ इमोशंस, पर्सनलिटी, रिलेशनशिप्स, कैरियर, प्रोफेशनल एंड पर्सनल ग्रोथ. वेलकम मिस पूजा पंजाबी ऑन अवर शो. मिस पूजा पंजाबी, यू हैव हर्ड डॉक्टर राजीव आनंद, मिस मिस पूनम पाठक एज वेल एज डॉक्टर अमिता छक्कर, एंड दे ऑल हैव गिवन देयर व्यूज. वी वुड लाइक टू नो योर व्यूज ऑन माइंड बॉडी रिलेशनशिप. मिस पूजा पंजाबी प्लीज.
Thank you, Mr. Goyal, for that lovely introduction. And Dr. Rajivanand, thank you so much for the platform that you've provided me and all my other colleagues for being here today. It was a pleasure listening to all of you and listening to the different perspectives that we have to share on the mind-body balance. So we've been talking about the mind-body, the disconnection, not being in sync. I would like to say that whenever the body and the mind are disconnected, we will experience disturbance, disease, disorientation. So anything, anytime you're disconnected, everything starts with the disturbance part, with your emotions, with your feelings, with your thoughts. There will be disease in the body because the mind communicates to us through our thoughts, through our feelings, and through our body. Now, thoughts, we put them aside. We ignore them. We don't pay attention because we are busy, as everybody has been saying from a very long time. We are busy in the rat race. We are not listening to ourselves. Feelings, we suppress. So it's easy. But body is something that no matter how much you want to push down or shut it down, it will not allow you to. So it's the most important channel through which the mind communicates, because the mind knows that if I hit the body, if I give it pain, you're going to go anywhere in the world to heal the body, because that is one part of our organ. It's the biggest part of our organ. And anywhere when there is pain in the body, we are not okay with pain. Nobody in this world will say, I'm happy with pain. If people say that, there is a disconnect. There's a major disconnect. Okay. So pain is something we want to avoid. And in the constant cycle of avoiding pain, we then start listening to the mind. And that's where the psychosomatic diseases, everybody, even the doctors today, researchers, scientists have agreed that everything is operating and coming from the mind. We know the basic scientific law of cause and effect. So the body is the effect and the cause is the mind. It is universal as well. Sometimes the mind can be the effect and the cause can be the body as well. So there is a very deeper connection between the mind and the body, which if understood correctly, we can all maintain a healthy balance. We don't have to be experts in this. We don't even have to study any courses. We just need to listen very carefully when our mind is talking to us. And how do we do that? So for example, before I tell you how we do that, the example that I would like to tell you is, in the last 2 years, we've all gone through a major shift with COVID. Everybody at some point or their in this 2 years experienced anxiety, panic, fear. And for each one of us, it came into the body in different ways. Some of us had the diseases which were in the body, and some of us went through mental and emotional changes. So for example, let's say somebody who had a panic attack. The symptoms will be you had palpitations, your heartbeat was fast, you're sweating, you're feeling that your chest is hurting, you're getting all the symptoms of a heart attack. But in actuality, what is happening is it's a panic attack. And in COVID era, I have seen a lot of clients with anxiety and panic attacks. So the body is going through the symptoms, but where it began was the thought. So let's go reverse, okay? The body is the last place where the mind hits. The mind is kind to us. It talks to us first through our thought, then the feeling, and then the body. So if the body is giving you a clue, it's a messenger. It's carrying a message from the mind. Now let's go back and let's decode the message that has been sent to us. So as Dr. Amita also said, if you have time, sit down and write. I would say if not every day, and don't even wait for a problem to start journaling. Because we always wait for something to happen to us and then we'll take precautions or then we'll start dealing with it. We took vaccinations even though we didn't have COVID because it was a precautionary method. So we take care of our mind even before something happens to us. We don't clean our houses because there are guests coming home. We clean our houses no matter what every day because we like to maintain hygiene. So if we are maintaining declutter outside, why are we not doing it within us? The biggest relationship, we want to maintain our relationships with our friends, family, with our colleagues, with our bosses, with our work. But the biggest relationship, we are not even looking at it, is the one that you have with yourself, which we are not paying attention to at all. We just take it for granted until and unless we fall sick. So illness becomes the channel which tells us now focus on me. You've not been taking care of me, you've taken me for granted, and now I'm going to give it back to you. So don't wait for that, rather start asking yourself these two questions and start writing them down. Simple questions: what am I feeling? Most of the times we don't even know what we are feeling. So if I have clients and I ask them suddenly out of the blue, what are you feeling? They start thinking, I don't know. So they just get confused. What did you just ask me? So next time when you're meeting people, instead of asking, how are you feeling? Ask, what are you feeling? Don't wait for the answer. Just leave it as a question to them. How are you feeling? Everybody says, okay, fine, good, bad. What are you feeling? Makes them think. So I want you to start thinking, what are you feeling? From there, you can take it a little step further. Ask yourself, what am I thinking? What is the thought? In the beginning, it's going to be a little difficult to identify. As I said, it's decoding. To decode karne mein thoda sa samay lagta hai. But start writing down random thoughts. It's okay. So what I do usually is I have a chart. Okay. Behavior, feeling, thought. And the fourth one is, how do I change the thought? So once I've identified the thought, now what do I do with it? This thought bothers me. For example, as I said, if it's a panic attack, the body is having all the symptoms. Now the feeling is fear, worry, or anxiety. The thought is, what if something goes wrong? What if it doesn't go my way? What will happen then? What will happen in the future? So these are the kind of thoughts. Now let's take it one step further and let's replace the thought. What would I like to think? That's my fourth column. What would I like to think? This thought is not helping me. The thought of what if, what will happen, is creating panic in me. It's creating anxiety in me. Now, how do I change it? I change it by, how do I want to feel? I want to feel happy. I want to feel peaceful. I want to feel calm. So I'll replace the thought with, I am okay. Trust me, with a lot of clients, COVID, not COVID, I have tried this. The moment you start reassuring the mind, I'm okay. I'm capable of taking care of things. I can adapt to different situations. And the biggest example, we all adapted to the lockdown, to being at home for 3 months. So as humans, we are very adaptable. When we were pushed to the corner, we all adapted. We all changed and shifted. If somebody had told you 2 years back, sit at home, work from home, 3 months, you'll be sitting at home doing nothing. We all would have laughed it out and said, what are you talking? I'm not going to do that. I can't sit at home. Mujhse nahi hota hai. It's not possible. But when there was a need, we all changed and shifted. So our mind is quite capable of adapting to different situations. It has a threshold. The threshold is different for each one of us. But we do have a threshold for adapting to new things. So then change the thought. Whatever thought makes you centered, peaceful, grounded, put that thought. And now start repeating the thought. Why repetition? as we all have been discussing for the past 1 hour, that the mind sends a message to the body. So the brain has neurotransmitters, those neuro pathways carry a message to the body, and then it brings about a shift in the cells of the body, in the muscles, in the organs, and then the body responds or reacts to it. This is how the entire cycle goes. It happens in a matter of seconds. Now, when I start repeating and replacing with a new thought, it'll take some time for the neuro pathway to start adapting to it, form a habit. So any habit, if you want to develop, it takes about 66 days or more to do it. So aap bologe ki, I did it for 6 days. I did religiously whatever you told me for 6 days. I changed the thought. I repeated every day. I'm fine. I'm capable and adaptable. And on the 7th day, I forgot to do it. It does not work like this. So the way, as I said earlier, we take care of our body, our hygiene. It's a habit. You don't have to have a reminder to brush your teeth, take a bath. I hope you all do that. But if we are doing it out of habit, right? In the morning, you get up. It's out of habit. You just go to the washroom. You do your morning ritual. In the same way, you have to make it a habit of doing it every single day for the next 3 months. And if you do it constantly, you are changing the neuro pathways. And when you're changing the neuro pathways, you are imbibing a new habit. When you imbibe a new habit, it becomes on autopilot. Then you don't even have to make an effort to do it. It just kicks in. So what we talk about, affirmations or positive thinking, it just doesn't happen. Some people have that energy, who are very positive, who are lively. They thrive even in crisis, okay? So that's because their neuro pathway, they are habitual of taking care and dealing with crisis in a different way. Their approach towards crisis is different. It's not that they don't feel hit by it, they don't feel depressed or they don't feel low, but they're not able to stay low for a longer time because the autopilot just kicks in. So you will have, I'm sure we've all met those kind of people who've had so many failures in life, but yet they have that spirit to try something new, to do something new. That's because they have that approach which they have followed and practiced for a long time, and now it comes in on autopilot. It just kicks in. So we all can adapt to that same thinking. We can all adapt to that same approach. It comes with practice and a little patience. So as Mr. Goyal was earlier saying, resilience. So be a little patient with yourself. When you're learning a new habit, for children, when you're teaching them to walk, they fall once. You don't give up on them, no? You just don't say, kya, theek hai, chhod do, tumse nahi ho payega. We again motivate them. It's okay, get up, you can do it. So how we are motivating children? When you're training your mind, you're talking and communicating with a child. So be patient. It's your own mind. Your mind is like a child. Give it some time. Help it to move out of it. So this is one way of dealing with the mind. Before we end, just one small thing I wanted to mention was Dr. Rajivanand mentioned about visualizations. Yeah, that is something that I really enjoy. The creative visualization or the guided imagery that we talk about. Our mind, before words are formed, thinks in pictures first. That's why when you see something or when you hear a sound, you can easily associate it to a memory from the past. And you can also create new memories. So when you teach a child, you show a picture. This is an apple. That's how you teach. Or this is a hand. You don't say hand, 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 and the child knows what is a hand. You associate it with a picture. So whenever you are adapting to a new behavior, the second thing what you can do is put a visual to it. So even if you're not very creative at drawing, I'm okay with it. Just make a vision of how you would like your life to be, or how would you like to feel peaceful? So if peace was a symbol, what symbol would you like to give it? Put a vision and do that every day before sleeping. Now, why we say before sleeping is because that's the only time when the conscious mind shuts down and the subconscious mind is active even in your sleep. So when you're taking those thoughts and going in your subconscious and you're carrying that vision with you, the subconscious starts working on it. and starts creating that kind of an approach for you. And that's how you learn how to deal with it. So you're not just working consciously now, you're working subconsciously also. So when you're doing the exercise of thought, feeling, and replacing the thought, that's for your conscious. And when you're putting a vision or an image, you're doing it for the subconscious. And when both of them come in sync with each other, that's when you attain your mind and body balance. So that is what I wanted to share about today.
Thank you very much, Ms. Pooja Punjabi. And she said one thing, how you are feeling. Instead of that, one should say what you are feeling. So thank you very much. Post your